get that many ad opportunities. Because when we met at Carnival City, I knew you were already. I told you, I've seen you on this ad. Might not have known your name at the time.
I was the guy from.
Yeah, you were the guy from. Because it felt like for a good 5-6 years, every time you switched on the TV, you were in a major ad.
Yeah.
Online or on TV, you were the ad guy. What is the magic trick?
So, man, it's, you know, these questions are very difficult to not feel like one is boasting so much as why you understand.
Yeah. One is?
It's a difficult one because, you know, you don't want to say, well, you know, it's
obviously as ability.
It's, yeah, but also, so.
But I mean, it can't be a mistake.
The thing we spoke about in the beginning. Yeah. Right. One of the things we spoke about in the beginning was, you know, I like the shortest distance between two points.
Yeah.
I also very quickly realized that there weren't many overweight, charming, colored guys going for auditions.
Yeah.
And when I looked at the way people who were coming to these auditions looked.
Yeah.
They all looked very similar. And when you look similar to anybody else, you are now competing with that person. And like I said, I don't like to join the long queue.
Yes.
I like the, you know, most efficient way. Yeah. And I think that's what worked. So I chose my spots. I chose which auditions I would go for.
Yeah.
If I knew that they were looking for a classic, stereotypical, thin, good-looking person,
I wouldn't go
and waste my time.
Yeah.
But if I knew that charm could win the scene,
yeah,
I would go.
And
that made my hit rate spectacular.
Mm. Actually, an interesting point.
I got one in two auditions I went for.
Fucking hell.
Through that time.
And for people that don't understand, there's a cattle call for most of these auditions.
Yeah.
So, I think that's your wife.
That is my wife.
So, there's a cattle call for these auditions. There are often more than 100 people there.
Mm.
Very often. And on the first day,
numbers, you get a sticker.
Yeah.
Sticker with the number. They don't call you by your name. Number 187.
Yeah. There's nothing that will bring you down to size like standing in those queues. That's why a lot of comics, you don't like to do it.
Yeah.
But now, from there to comedy.
Yes.
How did that happen? So now you at Macro, you...
I'm at Macro, joined the auditions.
Yeah.
I get a few ads. I end up getting Castle Lager, which was the biggest campaign I'd done to date at the time. I meet Siv, spend a week shooting Castle, and Siv goes, dude, try this thing.
Mm.
You're very funny. Try this thing.
Mm.
I mention it to Nicholas over some gentle drinking on Mother's Day. And Nick got a bee in his bonnet, called Taffia from WACT, and made an appointment. Taffia says to Nick, don't waste my time. Because when she heard that us cousins would like to go on the same night, we both have the same surname. She was like, listen, this is not a place. We have jokes on stage. We don't make jokes.
Mm, we're serious about this thing.
Don't say you're coming and not come.
And there's a... That would become the story of Goliath and Goliath.
If Taffia wasn't that hard on Nick, I would have postponed.
Is it?
Because I said to Nick, are you mad? He didn't ask me for permission, like, can you make the thing? He was just like, I also feel like doing it. Next morning, he made the call. And I said to him, no, you're crazy. And he was like, no, bro, that auntie fluked me. We got 6 weeks. Write your jokes. 3rd of July 2011, my life changed. I did comedy for the first time.
I can't explain it. For some of us that are supposed to be here, if you go on stage and it doesn't feel like this is the absolute only thing you want to do for the rest of your life, like breathing, it's not for you. If you're here for the fame, it's not for you.
Mm-hmm.
Both of us here, I could bet, I'd put everything in my bank account today. But both of us here, if you had given us any opportunity, we would always rather choose to be on stage. And even sometimes at a shitty place.
Mm.
That's why a lot of the times people don't get why premium comedians are a shitbox doing a stand-up. Because we love doing it.
It's, you know, I was saying to my wife, I loved 2019 with all its ups and downs, but there was not a single thing I did in 2019 that I wouldn't have done for free.
That's a big...
I loved every single job that I took on so much that I would have done for free because I was having a good time the whole way.